tendon injury of peroneal tendon, usually it's involving disruption of the superior peroneal retinaculum or SPR. And the mechanism is mimicking the lateral ankle injury, which involving the hind foot inversion. Therefore, clinically, peroneal injury is often underrecognized as a source of pain and ankle dysfunction. The peroneal muscles, we know it acts as a dynamic stabilizer of the ankle. And in an acute injury, a contraction of the peroneal muscles during dorsiflexion in an inverted foot will cause a peroneal subluxation or dislocation. And this event will be felt by the patient as popping mechanism, followed by ankle pain and swelling, and also not uncommon become chronic and persistent complaint behind the ankle. We're gonna see in this video the anatomy of peroneal muscles, which arise from the lateral compartment of the leg, innervated by SPN, and then it passes distally to the ankle through malleolar groove posterolaterally, and then the anterior border is fibrocartilage, rim of the fibula, laterally it protects by the SPR. In this video, we're gonna see the peroneal longus is subluxated, and then there is a SPR, which we're going to repair. And then posteriorly, it's bordered by the CFL and deep fascia of the leg, and then medially by the PTFL. Scope of injuries in peroneal tendon can be varied from tendinosis or tendonitis. And then there is peroneal tendon tear. And the last one is dislocation or subluxation. And for the purpose of the presentation today, we're gonna discuss more on the tear and dislocation with also some cases that I'm going to show. The most famous peroneal dislocation injury, probably this one, was when Curt Schilling, he is the pitcher from Red Sox, he performed against the Yankees on the MBL after he got his peroneal tendon repair surgery. And then he was bleeding through his socks, thus this game was famous for his bloody sock event. This is some of his personal posts sometime in 2014. These are what we're gonna find on patients. Usually patient with pain behind the fibula, and sometimes not uncommon, they also feel the apprehension of the dislocated tendon, and also fear of popping while doing certain exercise, such as running on an uneven surface. At the clinic, we can do the provocative maneuver, or if it is a chronic, patient can also show us the dislocated tendon. And do not forget to also evaluate the checklist on ankle pathologists, because we know that up to 40% of patients with lateral ankle injury happen to have peroneal tendon issue as well. I present this several studies from renowned foot ankle surgeon on their lateral ankle instability studies. For example, Van Dyck found that 23 until 77% pathology in peroneal tendon with lateral ankle instabilities. Also, Di Giovanni mentioned the same results in his primary ankle instability cases. He showed that 30% have a peroneal tendon tear. Standard imaging would be plain standing X-ray of the ankle in AP, lateral, mortis. If we can do dynamic ultrasound, it can be a great diagnostic tools as well. However, we know that dynamic ultrasound is operator dependent as well. CT can also be an option to see bony pathology, but most of my cases, I prefer MRI to evaluate the other soft tissue pathology inside the ankle and surroundings. Treatment will consist of conservative, which usually it's about functional rehab and also casting, and surgery for the refractive cases. On this presentation, I will show you three varieties of peroneal tendon injuries that we can see in our daily practice. The first one is chronic peroneal tendon dislocation with supernumerary peroneal quartus. And then the second, I will show you chronic peroneal tendon dislocation with peroneal brevis split tear. And then the last one is an associated peroneal tendon injury with a chronic lateral ankle instability. We're gonna go one by one. The first one is female, 42 years old, with a complaint of almost 2 years of pain behind ankle. She also complained of a chronic retromarella swelling, as we seen in the first picture. And then after patient is under anesthesia, we reproduce the dislocation. We can see this, the contour of peroneal longus is markedly on the behind of fibula. And then we plan the surgical landmarks. And then this is the imaging before we do the surgery. We have a suspicion of peroneal brevis split tear. As we see on the yellow circle, the peroneal brevis is flattened behind the peroneal longus. We're gonna see what happened when we do the surgery. So in surgery, we perform the groove deepening so the peroneal longus have the new place. And then instead of finding a split peroneal brevis, as we seen on MRI, we instead find the peroneal quartus inside the groove. And what does it mean? The existence of peroneal quartus will have effect. The first one, it will decrease the efficiency of eccentric muscles of brevis and longus. And then the second one, it will create overcrowding effect inside retromalleolar, causing narrowing of the groove and affecting the stability of ankle. Thus, it increased the risk of ankle injury. So in this case, we excise all the peroneal quartus, so the gliding between peroneal longus and brevis is clear, and then the groove deepening has already performed, and then the last one, we perform the soft tissue repair by using two suture anchor. Case number two is male, 54 years old, with history of 10 years peroneal dislocation because of occupational hazards. And then at the moment before a patient came to the clinic, patient present with pain from lateral calf down to the ankle. In the pre-op imaging, we can see that there is a disruption of the peroneal brevis. And then it's in the intraoperative findings, we find that there is a peroneal longus dislocation and then a consistent findings of peroneal brevis split tear, as it's shown on the green arrow, and then a large osteophyte. However, I've already excised it inside this picture, a large posterior of osteophyte, which caused the instability also at the peroneal longus. And the treatment is tubularization of peroneal brevis, and then the same groove deepening as case number one, SPA repair also using suture anchor, and then also osteophyte removal. This is an illustration that I captured from the journal from Richard Ferkel. He given a very nice tubularization image of tubularization, which we can use for a condition of split tear or also an intrasubstance tear. Case number three is a male, 30 years old. He is a basketball player with 5 years lateral ankle pain and recurrent instability. From the MRI, we found that there is a peroneal brevis split tear, also a chronic tear of the ATFL, and also a quite big anterior bony impingement on the sagittal view. For this patient, peroneal tendon injury is part of associated injury from the lateral ankle instability. So in this case, we plan to address all the issue because patient also have pain and instability. We want to repair the lateral ankle in ligaments. But first, we approach the lateral aspect of the fibula to find the intrasubstance peroneal brevis tear, which then we repair with the same tubularization techniques. And afterward, we address the intra-articular pathology, which is the very large bony osteophytes, which cause impingement on the anterior ankle, and also additional open lateral ligament repair. So the summary or take-home message of this discussion would be understanding the available consensus nowadays in treating peroneal tendon injury. There is two types of consensus at the moment, which is treating the athletes or elite athletes versus the non-athletes. While the elite athletes, it has to be a mandatory groove deepening with soft tissue repair. While the non-athletes, there is no consensus yet. That means that SPA repair only can also be an option. And then understanding that peroneal injury can be an isolated problem and or part of lateral ankle issue. Therefore, addressing associated injury, such as the peroneal tendon itself, can increase satisfactory result in treating patients with ankle injury. And then in terms of the surgical technique first, treating the overcrowding phenomenon by addressing surgically the risk factors such as low-lying muscle belly or findings of accessory muscle is a must. And then we also have to avoid over-tightening while we're repairing the soft tissue because we don't want to produce stenosis in the groove. I think that's all for now. Thank you for your attention. And I turn it to Dr. Andri. Thank you.
Yes.